Right. Welcome. How's everybody doing today? Hi. All right. So good to see you all. Look at everybody just entering in there. I'm so glad to have you. Okay. Is everybody's getting centered? Well, we could get centered too. That's a good thing. But as we're all getting settled in, sorry about that. Why don't we go ahead and in the bottom of the screen down there, you see the chat box. I know most of you have used this a million times by now, but you will see that chat box down there. You can go ahead and click on that. And today, if you don't mind, go ahead and click there and you can put in where you are calling in from. And why don't you tell us what the weather's like where you're from today? So if you don't mind putting that in there for us. And while you're doing that, my name is Alyssa. I am the manager of program delivery today, and I am going to be your host for today. So we're so glad to have you here on our therapy break. And I can't wait because we are talking about dance therapy today. So looks like we got a fun group. I see a lot of familiar faces out there. See a lot of people looking down on their computer, entering in some fantastic. Oh, somebody's humid in Tennessee. Yes, I understand that. Yes, yeah, hot and humid. Everybody's hot and humid. Oh, at least it's sunny. I'm in Orlando and we are overcast, but also very humid. Sunny and beautiful. You must be nice there, Shannon. Lucky you. You always have beautiful weather there, don't you? Pennsylvania, it's in mid-70s, but going up. Well, that's nice this time of day. Look, lucky you. All right. Well, we also have our closed captions on today. So if you see the words coming across the bottom of your screen and you find that completely annoying, that's okay, because we can turn that off. So if you also go down to the bottom of the screen and over to the right a little bit, you'll see a CC. You can click on that button and you will see where it says hide captions, and you can just click that and you can turn them off. So if you don't want to see them, just turn them off for it. You don't have to look at them the rest of the time. If you like them, just leave that alone, and that will help you to also read along while we're going through our program today. In that chat box though, where we are all entering in where we're calling from and what our weather is like, you can enter in your questions as we go through the program today. And I will be reading those to our speaker today in real time and trying to just give those to her as we're going through everything today. So we will keep the conversation going and get your answers to your question. So does that sound good to everyone? Yeah? See a few head nods out there? All right, perfect. Well, let's see, we got a little bit more. Let's see, we still got people coming in. All right, a few more coming in, a few more answers coming in. All right, well, I'm gonna go ahead and we are gonna introduce the most amazing speaker today. I am so excited to introduce Allie Warner to you. She is an OU Associate Professor of Dance out of Oakland University, which is in Detroit. It is not in California, because I made that mistake, just so you all know. Allie's so bad. Oh, fun. Okay, so she has actually a very unique dance company that she is the founder and director of, called Take Root. It is as I said, it's a very unique. It creates thoughtful and visceral works of art is how she describes it, but it truly is a way to connect movement and people. And she does that with the audience and the diverse circles of people. It's it just wants to a way to just make everybody just kind of draws you in and just really impacts with small movements and large movements. It's very explosive, but also very detailed at the same time. It's a really cool troupe that she has put together. And that actually led her to also starting with her Parkinson's dance for Parkinson's actually classes as well. And I will let her share a little bit more about how that all came about. She has taken this troupe around the world and performed. There's so many different countries that she has done this in that I'm not going to list them all because we'll be here for a while. She has also performed at Team Fox at their, hang on here. Oh, at the gala. Ooh, look at you, Allie. And also at the Henry Ford West Bloomfield Silent Witness Ceremony. She did start her Dance for Parkinson's program back in 2014. And she also has many other classes throughout Metro Detroit, the PD Expo, and she's done other several events. She was the 2016 Oakland County Executive Elite 40 Under 40 winner. She has had top honor for her creation of the Dance for Parkinson's Disease Program. She is also a guest lecturer for the Oakland University Health Science Neuroscience Interventions course and works closely with their physical therapy undergraduate and graduate programs. She does a lot of community work. She does a lot of going out and talking to different people, including how lectures and demonstrations on how dance and music impact children. And she is also named a finalist of the Governor's Fitness Awards back in 2016. So what, Allie, I'm so curious about this. What your bio that you sent over did not mention, which I have to admit I geeked out about, because what I did not tell you is I was a dancer once myself, but you were a rockette.
It was.
And you didn't mention that.
No.
Not in this bio. I had to dig deep and I found that part.
Yeah,
and to tell you, your dance history is so long. It's amazing the things that you have accomplished.
I've lived a lot of lives.
But everybody, this is Allie. Allie, please share more about you and whatever you want to share with us today. Everybody, this is Allie.
Thank you, Alyssa. Hi, everybody. Absolutely. It's so nice to be here. I'm so excited to see all of your faces. And I think the silver lining in being able to be on Zoom is that I get to meet all of you without having to fly all over the country to see all of you. This is much better than all that traveling. That was a lovely warm welcome and a long list. Sometimes I forget about all of that work, you know, we're just going day by day here. So just a little introduction about me is what was already said, is that my name is Allie, and I am very honored to be here with all of you today. I am, I think of myself as a student constantly, and how much I have learned over the past several years with the Parkinson's community is just invaluable to me. And I am humbled to be able to learn and then be able to give as much back as I can and continue to learn. So today is as much learning for me as it is for you. And I'm thrilled to be here and to be a part of this very special hour with all of you. So what we're going to do today is a little different maybe than what you've done before. I'm a dancer and a very active human being. So for me to sit and listen for an hour is never good because I start to get thinking about dances that I could create or other things. So I usually when I do things such as this, symposiums or lectures, I like to call them lecture demonstrations because we're going to move. As we're doing this, I will explain some things and talk about some things about dance for Parkinson's disease, but we're also going to put those words into practice so that you can have a chance to experience it with me, instead of just listening and me trying to tell you how wonderful it is. because why not? We're all here together. So we're going to start off that way today. I find that when I meditate and when I do deep breathing and start to get my body moving, I not only listen better, but I also take in the information into my body a lot better. And then I find that my experiences are just richer. So I'm not using my phone for anything except for to turn music on, just so you don't think I'm sitting here doing two things at once. But what I am going to ask you to do is, if you would like to participate in the movement, that you can just move your arms out to the side. And if there's anything in front of you, like a glass of water that you might, you know, knock over. I've done that in the past when I've been teaching class and forget that it's there. So we just want to be able to extend our limbs a little bit as much as you can. I do want to say before we start any kind of movement is that it's all up to you of what you want to do. This is a judgment-free zone. So by no means am I looking at these squares and going, well, that woman's not doing it and that guy's not participating. This is all for you. So as much as you get visually, that might be enough, or just listening to the music might be enough for you today. I say that in our Dance for Parkinson's classes, every class, it is what you need for today. That might mean just listening or just sensing, and not necessarily as much movement as maybe the next day. So I want to give that disclaimer right out. Okay, so what I want you to do is we're going to put one hand, I'm going to play a little bit of music, and I'll put it somewhat quiet so that it's not too loud over my voice. So hopefully you can hear a little dinging, a little kind of rhythm that's coming up. And I want you to put, I'm going to back up a little bit. I want you to put one hand on your chest and one hand on your belly. And we're going to just take some deep inhale, exhales in through our nose and out through your mouth. And I want you to actually make the noise as you exhale. Like that. And keep doing that a couple more times. A deep inhale and exhale. And this time when you do it, I want you to think of your spine getting a little longer. And as I exhale, sunshine coming out at the top of my head, and I feel my feet on the bottom of the, my bottom of my feet on the floor, pressing down into the floor. So not only am I getting longer through my spine, but I'm feeling energy going both directions. I'm going to circle my arms up over my head like this and bring my hands down to heart center. And open them back up nice and wide, as if I'm in a snow globe and I'm scraping the sides of the snow globe. Do that again. So I'm scraping my sides of the snow globe, bringing it all in. And I'm still breathing in and out nice and easy all the way out my snow globe. I'm going to take one arm up and over. Just nice and easy. I can always put my opposite arm on my chair for balance, but I'm keeping those feet. Other arm, keeping my feet flat on the floor as much as I can. And I'm scraping my snow globe as I do it. This time my arm comes up and reaches all the way across as I'm reaching to all of you. And then I touch my shoulder, give myself a little rub on that shoulder. Just some extra love for today. And then I open it back up, reaching out to all of you, passing on all that energy. Other side, reaching my arm up, coming over, find that opposite shoulder, and I'm going to rub that shoulder a little bit, give it some love. Maybe I go across my back a little bit, and then I come back over. I'm going to put my hands on my legs and just rub them side to side, front to back, like skis. So I'm going this way on my legs. I'm just getting a little bit of heat. And I'm going to press a little bit into them. Not too much, nothing that makes it hurt or uncomfortable, but just giving a little bit of weight into my hands. Good. And now I'm going to take that heat and start rubbing it as if I have a ball in my hand. And I'm rubbing it around in my hand. I'm going to do different angles with my hands. So I'm going to keep that ball of energy as I'm just moving my hands around, moving my arms around, Yep. Now I'm going to get it a little bit bigger. Here's my ball. And I'm just going to start rotating it. Now, my ball is aqua. Your color could be anything you want. Here's my ball. I'm going to throw it and catch it in my other arm. Now I got to keep it there. Right? So I've got to keep it balanced in my hand. Throw it to your other one. Ooh. Keeping it balanced in my hand. Nice and easy, rolling it around. Other one. Mm-hmm. Good, everybody. You are excellent ball rotators. Now, I'm going to throw it up, and I'm going to catch it on my shoulder. I got to keep it on my shoulder. Don't let your aqua or whatever color your ball is to fall off your shoulder. Now it's going to move down. Find it on your elbow. Good, everybody. I'm going to move it over to my other elbow. Whoop. Now you can go as slow or as fast as you want, as long as you can balance that ball. I'm going to move it up to my shoulder. Good, everybody. Now I got a challenge for you. I'm going to move it up to the top of my head. Keep that ball on the top of your head. Now later, if somebody asks you what you did today, you can say you balanced an imaginary aqua ball on your head. What did you do today? Show them that. Good, everybody. Okay, here's a good one. We're gonna pop it off the top of our head like a gumball, and it lands in our mouth. Chew. Keep those muscles moving in your face. Chew that gum. Right, I'm gonna blow a big bubble. A little bigger. A little bigger. So you got your bubble? All right, let it float around. Maybe I take my feet off the floor, maybe one foot, maybe not both, maybe one. But I'm gonna fly around a little bit. Put it in my other hand. Really reach with that bubble. And I'm gonna let it go. And I'm just gonna float back down to earth. All the way back down, nice and easy. Find yourself nice and planted. Get those feet back to the ground. Nice and parallel. My hands on my chest and my belly. Inhale and exhale. What a great ride that was. Inhale and exhale. One more. Nice, lovely exhale. Good job, everybody. That was a lovely, I hope your ride on your bubble was as fun as mine. So that gives you a little bit of an idea of how we start our classes for Dance for Parkinson. The classes that I like to teach, and I'll go back on how we started this program, but the classes that we teach are not just dance classes. So we get a lot of questions when we start providing these classes, or we have new members that come in that say, well, I'm not really a dancer, or that's too much for me. I don't think that I'd be able to do that or whatnot. And our classes, I like to say first and foremost, I am not going to make you a Broadway star nor a professional dancer. I am sorry to say, but that ship has sailed. But what I do say is we're going to be real creative. I'm going to ask you to use your creativity and be thoughtful and use music and movement to provide creativity and joy and activity. So what happened way back when I started the company of Take Root, I was really just thinking that I would start. I had come to Detroit and on faculty at the university, and had been involved in what I like to say specialized dancing, meaning that I had worked with hearing impaired dancers, just different communities that were not your quote regular dancers. And I always found that to be extremely fulfilling for me, and that I was learning outside of my box of what was expected, I guess. So when my dad's best friend, he was diagnosed with PD, now it's been 20 years. But in 2014, he had taken a dance class in a location close to where I am, and called me, which he never calls. So that was a big deal that he called and said, "I've never felt this good. Do something about this." He's a very direct person. So I said, okay, I guess I'll have to figure it out. So I looked it up and found that Mark Morris in Brooklyn, New York was training dancers in Dance for PD, got funding from our university, flew out to New York, was trained in 3 days, came home, and it was exceptional training. I never thought it would be the way that it was. I was so excited and inspired to start a group. Came back and met with we have a very large support group in Rochester, especially in one of the cities, suburbs of Detroit. And they have, 75 members in their support group. So I went and I said, "Hey, I'm going to start a dance class. If anybody's interested, we're going to do it once a month at the university." The university was all about it because our university, thankfully, is very supportive of community work. And so I set up the class for the first Saturday of every month. And our first class, I had 40 people show up, and I thought, well, I better know what I'm doing. Like, this is, I was thinking we might have four, but we had 40. And then since then, so this is Oakland University, which is out of Rochester, Michigan. So then since then, we fast forward to now, and I have two people on faculty for me. So there's three of us that teach, and we have four different locations, one in Detroit, one in Pontiac, which is also a city in Michigan, at the St. Joseph Mercy Oakland Hospital, and a wellness center called the Older Persons Commission, and Oakland University. So we are busy with providing these classes. We also, as what was mentioned earlier from Alyssa, is that I'm involved with the health sciences, physical therapy, and graduate physical therapy students at the university. So they are now required to volunteer, which I think is funny. They're required to volunteer. So yes. So they have to come to at least one class a semester and assist the class, so that they are getting one-on-one, hands-on experience with our PD community. And several of them continue to come and come back, and they are not required to do that, but they come back. So that is really special. We have a very unique setup here, which is great. It's just amazing of how much the program has grown and how much we're able to connect with the PD community. So what I want to talk about briefly is why dance for Parkinson's is so important. And the topical reason is that you're getting exercise. That's great. So as we all probably know that living with Parkinson's disease, the more you move, the better. That you got to stay moving and stay engaged. So that is obviously a reason number one that it's so beneficial, is that you are moving, you are engaged, and you're having activity. But what is so amazing about the Dance for Parkinson's program is that we are also exercising your brain as much as we're exercising your body. So the creativity, like what I just had you do, I don't know many programs that have you float around on a balloon that you blew up from an imaginary ball in your mouth. So that in itself is having your brain work, like it's creating these stories and this information and parts of your brain that might not be used all the time. So that's really, really important that we're able to do that. So in our classes, we use a lot of art. We'll use, I'll bring art pictures and say, okay, we're gonna like notice some of the shapes that are from this picture. How do we make those shapes through our movement? There's all these different ways to use creativity to provide movement to then not only have you physically active, but mentally active. That is just as important. And I find that not only does that help our participants in terms of creativity, but also in their own confidence and in their own daily life of moving forward, of feeling really good when they leave the class, not just because that they were doing stretches, but also because they created something on their own that was theirs and then shared it with others. I noticed that this is across the board. So we work with Take Root, also has arts education outreach, which is an entire different topic, but not really, because we do the very similar things with our young kids, of being confident, of using movement and music to help problem solve, to help feel confident, to help with their daily life. So this is a really, really important part of our Dance for Parkinson's that is not really available in other forms of exercise, maybe. So also what is important about it is that we're working on specific issues with PD. So balance, gait, movement through torso, spinal lengthening, figuring out our metatarsals of how, obviously I'm using my hands, but to work through your feet, focus, all of those things that we work through with our exercises. We're going to do another one in just a minute that I'm going to put you through. It's horrible. That I'm going to ask you to join me in doing. And many of our participants will say, oh, you know, that now that I think about it, that exercise is really similar to stuff that we do in my physical therapy. And I said, yes, exactly. This is all smoke and mirrors. I'm having you work. Like, we are really doing a lot of work with our entire body, but also, as I mentioned earlier, also with your brain. So It's remembering movement. It's putting them in order. That's really important for our brains also, remembering what comes next. So it's not just I'm no disrespect to physical therapy. Let me say that outright, that I think there is a valid reason for physical therapists, and I am thankful for all of them, but I prefer to not do, you know, 8 leg lifts that I can do with no real, thought behind it, where I can turn on in a minute here Stevie Wonder and do some spinal twists and feel pretty good about it and not realize that I just worked really hard. That's what we're going to do right now. So what I'm going to have you do, I'm going to back up again. This is where I'm backing up so you can see me better. So I'm going to walk you through what we're going to do, and then we're going to put on some music. I'm going to grab this. We're going to put on some music. And we'll do it to the music, okay? So what I want you to think about is that I'm going to lift my arms as if somebody's underneath me, lifting from underneath my armpits and underneath my triceps. So I'm lifting under and then floating them back down, and lift a little bit higher and floating them back down. And I'm going to do that 4 times, to where the 4th time is I'm all the way up to the ceiling and floating back down. Now I'm going to cross in a diagonal, leading with the back of my hand, 4 times, a little quicker. 1 and 2, as if I'm painting the air whatever color I want. I did that 4 times. The 5th time, I'm going to do a big circle, or a port-a-bras is what we would call it, and land with my palm up. And now I'm going to twist my palm twice on the way down. 1 and 2. Now I'm going to do that all again. So I have 1 and down and 2. And down a little higher, and down and all the way up. And now I'm going to paint 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. The 5th one opens all the way up, and I turn my palm over and over. Now I'm going to do the same idea, but this time I'm going to spiral through my torso so that my arms are going front to back. Same idea, up and down and up and down a little higher and a little higher. This time I'm going to reach 4 times to the ceiling. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. And I'm going to stomp my foot, stomp. And I'm going to put my heel down 3 times. 1, 2, 3. And I'm going to do that again. Stomp. 1, 2, 3. Then I start again. Up and down and up
and down and up. Nice, easy spiral through my torso. And then I reach four times, two and three and four, stomp my foot, three heel drops, stomp my foot, three heel drops. Then I have a minute just to kind of boogie, because I love to have little moments of improvisation where everybody can do whatever they want to do. You can be as silly or do what we've done, or just find the beat in the music. And then we'll pick it back up where we were before, where we start all over again with our sweeps, okay? So I'm gonna put on a little music. Let's see if you can hear it. Can we hear that coming? Yeah. All right, so we're sitting up nice and tall. Sweet. And two. Three. And four. Sweep across. Two. Three. Four. Open it up. Palm goes down. Down and down. Good. One. Two. Three. Four. Four sweeps. One. Two, three, four. Open it up. Palm goes down. Good. Front to back. Good. Four reaches. One, two, three, four. Stomp your foot. Drop those heels. Good. Reach. Good. Four reaches. Stomp. And stomp. Now we can just do a little whatever you're feeling. Start all over. Sweep. One. And two. And three. And four. Reach it across. One. Two. Three. Four. Big sweep. Down. And down. And sweep. Good. Bring it across. One. Two. Big sweep. Good. And open. Reach to the ceiling. And stop. Stop. Good. Reach it. Reach it. Reach it. Let's take a deep breath in. And exhale out, and another deep breath in, and exhale out. So this gives you an idea. What we just did is worked our whole upper body, and you were working your brain because you were remembering what comes next. You were remembering the order. When I work with our physical therapists, I'll have them tell me, what did we work? What body parts did we work? And in what way? And they'll say, oh, we worked all through their torso and spiraling. We were pushing into the ground. We were working through the length of our arms and really stretching. I've had participants tell me, I'll turn on Stevie Wonder from class that you did, and then I'll reach to get my soup cans and I'll do it to a beat. And I feel so much more accomplished when I do that. So there is something that's really beneficial about music and finding a rhythm with music that helps us day to day. I'll go, okay, I'm gonna walk to that rhythm. And then our brain attaches to that movement and to that rhythm and go, oh yeah, okay, sure, I'll give you that. I can move in that way. That's huge. So some of the homework that I'll give our participants is to say, I want you to turn some music on at home and I want you to find the beat to that music. Whether it's tapping on my legs, whether it's clapping, whether it's drumming, find two spatulas and start
you know, beating on the table, anything to help find that rhythm and that pace. It also helps gait to do that, where I'm working on my gait, I'm walking around the house with rhythm, and there's confidence that comes with that. And our, again, brain and body that is worked through in that exercise. So that's really important. So what I want to talk about for a moment is the difference in dance for Parkinson's and other exercise. I'm going to say, yes.
They want to know how you get reimbursed.
How I get reimbursed?
Mm-hmm.
How I get paid?
Yeah. How do you get paid?
I don't get paid. nope. Well, you know, my husband's like, I mean, anytime, is that good? No, that's not why we're doing it, sweetie. Well, we take root functions off of grants. So we apply for as many grants as we can find. The classes that we do at all locations, except for the wellness center, because you have to be a member of the wellness center that's here. So then the participants have to pay for that. Otherwise, our classes are free. And we do that on purpose. We really, really want to make sure that any funding that you have is going towards your medical, whatever you need. And we don't want to add to that. So, and make that a reason why you can't come. So that was something that I decided right off the bat, was that we would not charge people on my account. If they charged for the places where, like the wellness center, I can't tell them not to do that. Otherwise, we can't have class there. But I can say donation based. If you want to donate, great. If you can't today, we're still going to have you in class and want to have you there. So we function off of all grants, and then those grants are what pays my faculty. And that's what we do. So it's not really, we'll do it as long as, you know, we've been doing it since 2015. So far so good. COVID wasn't so much fun for anybody, obviously, but what we did do is, we did a lot of Zoom classes. They're on our website, where people could go back and do them again. And in September, we started the university in September once a month, which is great. And we can Zoom our classes that we do there. So any of you are welcome to join us. We'll Zoom our classes from there and also record them and put them on our website that way. There was another question.
Do you get support from the university?
Yes, but not. We get a lot of support in that they let us be there. So I don't have to pay to be there, which is that's a gift, right? So I'm not paying for space, which is awesome. And Take Root has, because we're considered a company in residence there. So under our contract is we get paid to be a company in residency there. So some of that comes out of, but in terms of like a weekly class, no. Definitely not. But again, that's, you know, in a perfect world, we would all make a ton of money and live, you know, on a beach or in the mountains and fly to get to work on a cloud. I mean, you know, whatever. So we're hoping that we can get more grants as time goes on. We got some COVID grants too, so that was really good for us. So what I want to talk about real quick is that the differences in our classes, I mentioned it a little bit before about the creativity. And I think first and foremost, whatever exercise you do is wonderful. So just if it's not dance, whatever, if you're doing boxing, if you're walking, if you're doing yoga, if you're swimming, if you're doing meditation, if you're doing all of those are huge. And I'm a big advocate for wellness in general. So Take Root always hosts, I say always, obviously not this year, but in the past we have hosted a, what we call a PD Expo, and we host wellness classes for a day that are offered in our area for those living with PD. So my friends who do boxing for PD and yoga and Pilates and dance, we put it all in one day in one space so that those living with PD could come and try out all those different types of wellness activities and then decide, well, maybe I want to try that again, because we're very aware how hard it might be for those living with PD to drive to certain places, to spend the energy to go there, and then to not enjoy it. So I think it's really, really important. But I think that for us, what's really important is that the community aspect. So we encourage not just those with PD to come to our class, but their caregivers, their partners, their spouses, their children, so that it's not them that's having the experience, but it's also those that are in their life having that experience. We have found that the quality of life for all of those involved with PD is huge. So if those living with PD are happy and joyful, then that echoes into their family and into their everyday life. So, you know, there are some caregivers that are exhausted and are having a hard time with living with the diagnosis of PD themselves. So to have them come into the dance class and experience that moment of release and joy and watch their partner experience that, that is huge and really, really important. We host a Father's Day class or a Mother's Day class. I was just telling this to Alyssa before the class started, before this started. And we encourage those to bring their children or their grandchildren to come to class. I bring my children. And it's really important for them to get to see their loved one, you know, an eight-year-old, to see their grandfather joyful and dancing and moving and not what they have seen maybe at home, which is tremors and frustration and depression and that sort of those issues. So we find it really, really important to break down that wall of the stigma of PD and bringing in family members and bringing in the quality of life. And that is really, really important. So that's a big difference in what our classes offer or what the Dance for Parkinson's classes offer versus boxing or yoga or something like that. So we do some activities called mirroring where we partner people up and they have to mirror what the other person does. And that's all with laughter because everybody just starts joking around and doing, you know, like this or something. And there's no judgment in that, which is really wonderful. So something that I want to do with you right now is not mirroring, but I'm going to put on a little bit of music, and I highly encourage you to, if you would like to close your eyes. I did this yesterday in our PD class that I hosted yesterday. And at one point I looked around the room and everybody had their eyes closed. It was really beautiful because they were just mentally into what we were doing and listening to the music. So what I want you to do is you have your assignment in this exercise is to draw circles. Any kind of circle that you want, small, big, could be more of an oval, whatever. I'm not gonna look at your work and judge it and give you a grade. So, but I'm gonna call out the body part that you have to use to draw your circle. Okay. So that's the only rule, is that you have to use the body part that I'm asking you to use. Okay. And we're just drawing circles. So I'm gonna put on a little bit of music and we're gonna start drawing circles. Okay, we're going to start with our elbow. So any circle you want with your elbow, you can do both elbows, you can do one at a time, big ones or small ones. Switch to your knees, circles with your knees, big or small, just with either one or both knees. Thank you. nose, just your nose. Pinky fingers. Everybody, that was beautiful. I saw all kinds of circles that were happening. So this is my smoke and mirrors. You just used a ton of side work, torso work, sternum work, leg work, neck work, arms, extension, contraction, extending. You did all that stuff in 2 minutes.
And you felt it too.
It was a lovely background. Yeah. Right? Yeah, it's work. Like, you're doing it, but it was beautiful. So I saw a question here that I've worked with a lot of different populations, and what do I think that makes the Parkinson's community special? So much. I think what's special about, I mean, that's such a, how long you want to hang out and talk about right? that? I think there is, you are, the community of Parkinson's is a, nothing beats you down. I mean, gosh, I can have a bad day and then come to a class and go, but you're here. Like, I am just flabbergasted every time those participants show up, and how hard it is for them to show up, but yet they do, because they know that it's going to be better to be around others. They know that that things could get better. The outlook on life, the humbleness of the group, the persistence, the nonstop, the day to day, all of that teaches me every day of the value and the quality of our lives, that I just am blown away by. And that might sound, you know, cheesy, but I can say I've danced all over the world and have been in some of the most beautiful theaters in the world and have danced in front of thousands of people. And none of that feeling compares to the feeling that I get from the Parkinson's classes. It just doesn't. It's just not the same. It's a moment of feeling really great, and then the letdown. This lasts forever, and the connections with these participants and hearing about the stories and their children or their lives or what they did that day or their humor or their just all of it is. I'm a very fortunate person to get to be involved in it. There's a question of how are my classes evaluated and what is the turnover and how do I know what we're providing, what people need? That's a really good question. So about 2 years ago, we started to offer evaluation forms. At the beginning, like in September, we kind of think of our year starting in September through May, I would say. We still teach the classes during the summer, but it's not quite as busy in the summer. So because people travel, they take time off and they, you know, go up north. Here, going up north in Michigan is you know, beautiful, going up and taking time in the Great Lakes. And so when people say go up north, that's what they mean. So we would have people fill out forms, and it can be, they can put their names on it, don't have to, but it gives us an idea of the diagnosis, of how long they've had it, of some problem areas, what they struggle with the most, what bothers them. I mean, some participants really don't like high string violins, let's say, or just giving us a feel of what motivates them or what really deters them from wanting to come to class. If they're by themselves, if they have a caregiver or a spouse that comes with them, their favorite moments, the least favorite moments of class. It gives us an idea of how we can change as we're going along. And then recently now we've started with, because we have such fabulous interns that work for us, if they provide a phone number, then halfway through the, or two times during the year, our interns will call and say, how are you? How's everything going? How are the classes? What can we do different? Just that personal moment of, I love seeing you in class and we just want to check in. But it also allows us, if somebody isn't coming to class, to really find out what's going on. And if it's something that we can help, or if it's just reaching out and saying, we heard that you're not feeling well and we hope that you're coming back, and just getting back. So we do have a core of folks that have been with me since the beginning. They are my ride or die kind of crew that we've had, that do not miss class, that they definitely come. But we do have a pretty decent turnover too. That was the other question. So it depends on what's going on. I mean, we have, everybody has their group as to, so like the Detroit group, because it's far too, like Southeast Michigan, it takes a while to get to certain places, which is why we offer classes. So the Rochester group, that seems to be, they don't really cross over that much. So the Rochester group, the Pontiac group, the Detroit group, and then each faculty member has that. So it's interesting to, we change up who teaches every once in a while so that everybody gets to know everybody in terms of the faculty. But there is some turnover. I mean, there's, you know, when I started, and that was 2015, when we really started going, you know, that was 6 years ago. It can happen in 6 years. So we've lost members, and then we've gained some, we've lost, and then they've come back, and, you know, things like that. So,
so they want to know if you've been using masks for in-person classes.
Yes. So that's tricky also, as you all know. So when we were doing our Zoom classes, we actually weren't allowed to be inside without masks on at the university. We could be inside with masks to do our Zooms. But we decided to be outside because then you could see our faces. So we would be outside in chairs. So there's a couple of videos on our website of us in like ski coats outside. It was cold.
That's challenging.
Because we were like, we want you to see our smiles and what we look like, right? So now currently, the wellness center where we are and the university where we are, it is mandated to be vaccinated. So that allows us to not have to wear masks inside, which is, people still can if they want to, if they'd feel better wearing masks, but they have to be vaccinated to be there. So that makes all of us feel much more comfortable. Even though for a PD class, you know, we're spread out and whatnot, we're definitely 10 feet away from each other, if not more, but still the idea of, you know, everybody's kind of tiptoeing into the water here right now of figuring out what works for everybody. So, but again, we're trying to provide as much opportunity for every person. So if they're not comfortable coming, even if they're vaccinated, to be inside, then we record them and put them on our website, and we do it that way, or you can do it through Zoom, and then there is that interaction. So we're really trying to make the best of a really sticky situation,
yeah,
as much as we can.
We have a few more minutes with Allie, so if you have any last questions, please feel free to put them in the chat. Allie, I will share the very first Dance for Parkinson's class that I got to attend. Somebody walked in and they had a tremor, and they were just, you know, it happens. Yep. So he walked in, he had his tremor going, and they sat down to class. And as they started going, within a few minutes, tremor was completely gone. Yep. And I was amazed. I was just like, what just happened? And as the class just went on, it was settled. And I was like, maybe he just took his medicine. It couldn't just be the class. Class ended, everything was going about. And then he just looked amazing. And so I had talked to him afterwards and I'm like, did you just take your medicine before class? He's like, no. Nope. And I was like, oh, okay. Yeah. I was like, what just happened? And, you know, after talking to the instructor, she's like, that's just what happens. You know, you're just using a different part of the brain and you're focusing in on it. It's just that it just shuts off. And as I got to know him years later, I had asked him about it. It was because I had just started with this group and I'd asked him about it. And he said, yep, it happens all the time. He says, it's just using that your muscles, you're using a different part of the brain. And it just literally turns my tremor off. It amazed me. It still amazes me
that that happens. I see it all the time. And I think it's just shocking that because I'll have people come in that are really moving. I mean, with the tremors and the full body that could happen. And then we start doing like the circle exercise and then, and all of a sudden it's, I mean, like liquid, they're just moving. And I'm thinking,
fluid. And the opening, like it's small, stiff, and all of a sudden they're big and they're moving. It is incredible to see what can happen in dance for Parkinson's.
Well, and we try to tell our participants, you know, you can, there's so many different levels within the class. You can do it seated. You can do it standing. We do part of our class standing for those that can. There's all these different options that they can have. And then we encourage them to do that at home. So I'll never forget, it was maybe the second year that I was teaching and a gentleman and his wife had been coming for a while. And finally he came up to me and he said, we've been dancing in our kitchen now every night for the past about a year. And I just wanted to let you know that's what awesome. We do now. And I was like, give me a second.
Right.
I was like, okay, that's
and
great.
The flexibility too, which is really important. The flexibility that you gain when you are doing these classes regularly is amazing. I you watch people who were very stiff and we all know how muscles get stiff with Parkinson's. And then turning around within a couple of years and they're touching their toes and they're able to really move and do things and strengthening up that core of the body is so important for falls, for I'm really just for everything. Let's just be honest, core muscles are everything to us. So it really can do a lot. And a lot of people are scared when they see dance for Parkinson's, they're like, I can't dance. And you're like, it's not ballet. It's not the tango. It's not.
Well, and we have a big, you know, we go through a lot of times if I have a new participant and driven by their spouse or their caregiver and the spouse or caregiver will come in and they say, I'm just dropping them off. And I said, no, come on. Nope. Come on. Why don't you come in? Why don't you come and take class? Well, I'll just sit in the corner. Okay. Nope. Definitely can't do that. So if you're in this room, you're moving with me. If you're not in this room, then you have the choice. But if your person can't be here on their own, you get to dance with me. So come on. And then they love it. But it's that moment that spouses and caregivers also have a moment of, I don't know, like maybe this isn't for me. Maybe this is too much or they'll judge or whatnot. I said, no, this is where, and then once they do it once, they go, oh, wow. That was actually, I was getting a workout and I really had fun and I didn't have to tap dance or do ballet or, you know, I mean, we're using the terminology, but you know.
Exactly. And care partners can join in. Family members can join in. It's not just for the person with Parkinson's.
Well, and we have a bigger chance of them doing it at home if the spouse or caregiver is doing it with us. Cause then they say, oh, I love that exercise. We did that at home all week. We were blowing bubbles and doing all this stuff all week long. So thank you for that. They wouldn't have done that otherwise. Okay. But if you ask the PD person to explain that to their caregiver, not as easy as if they were in the room, you know, experiencing it themselves. That's really important for just that, as I was saying to Alyssa earlier, breaking that fourth wall. It doesn't need to be the PD community and then everybody else. We need to, this is not scary. We all need to work together to really build this kind of community wellness movement.
Absolutely. Well, we have a minute left. Is there any words of inspiration you would like to share with the group?
I would say my website is on there. So if anybody wants to email me, you are welcome to anytime. The email comes to me, not some faculty member or somebody that doesn't know that I did this today. So, you know, they're like, what? I don't understand. Who is this person? So you are welcome anytime to email me. I would say my biggest piece of advice, which I mean, you guys give me as much of advice as I give you, but to continue moving. Just keep moving a little bit every day, whether it's your brain that's moving, your body that's moving, the music is moving you, whatever, anything that gets you moving, even that much in a day is worth it. So if you need to email me and I need to like put it in cap letters in an email back that says, get moving, I have no problem doing that to you. I have twin 10-year-olds. I'm well-versed in getting people moving. So I have no problem doing that, but that's my biggest piece of advice is to really keep moving. And hopefully that's through a wellness program that you enjoy. Cause if you don't enjoy it, you won't want to do it. But I highly encourage you to try a dance class or to Zoom on with us sometime, or, you know, I can guarantee there's something in your area. I know that Alyssa can help with that, of finding the places of where they're offered, where you are.
Absolutely. And if you all can take yourselves, put yourselves back on camera. We would love to give Allie a wave of gratitude. We got a lot of thank yous for your generosity and for sharing your gift with all of us today. So thank you so much, Allie. We loved having you on. Pleasure. And everybody, please, wave of gratitude. Thank you. Thank you so very much. We hope to see you again soon, Allie.
I hope so too. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. See you soon.